Hello, and welcome to episode 9 of BCEC.online. Yes, we're heading into the 9th week of lockdown where we're having online church services. And although the government is saying they're going to start looking how to ease this situation in lockdown, we're still not sure what that means for places of worship. So for the foreseeable future, we're still going to be gathering this way through our online life groups and also through our Sunday service this way. Shall we start with a word of prayer?
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace.
Where there is hatred, let me sow love.
Where there is injury, pardon.
Where there is doubt, faith.
Where there is despair, hope.
Where there is darkness, light.
Where there is sadness, joy.
O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek
to be consoled as to console,
to be understood as to understand,
to be loved as to love.
For it is in giving that we receive.
It is in pardoning that we are pardoned.
And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life.
Amen.
And now I invite you all as part of our church to come together and pray this prayer.
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console,
to be understood as to understand,
to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are all born to eternal life. Amen.
I know during these times of lockdown and uncertainty, many of us may start feeling anxious or lonely. I want to share today something called the Rafa Listening Service, and it's brought to you by the Bethel Health and Healing Network. Let me play this video for you now.
Do you ever feel anxious or low? Do you have a lot of thoughts running through your head? Do you want to talk things through but have no one to listen? I mean, really listen. Here at Bethel Health and Healing Network, we offer a free and discreet listening service. It's called Rafa Listening, and it's for anyone in need. Our listeners are fully trained and will help you to feel at ease with talking things through. No matter what's on your mind, we're here to listen without judgment. To find out more, just call 07825 221 150 or visit bethelnetwork.org.uk and click on our services. That's 07825 221 150 or visit bethelnetwork.org.uk and click on our services. If you want to talk, we're here to listen.
Please, if you or someone that you know could use this service, be sure to reach out to them. You can book a call through the website or you can call them directly and arrange an appointment. Do make sure you're looking after yourself and those around you through this service. We're also going to launch a new segment for today's service, and it's called Storytime. So let's have a look. Hi, Matt. Good to see you. I think we're here today to hear you tell and share your story about how you got to know Jesus and how things went from there. Maybe it'd be great if you just tell us a little bit about yourself, like when, like where were you born and how did you first hear about God?
Yeah, so I was born in 1989. I was born in a place, in a little small market town in Banbury. And, you know, I was raised in a non-Christian family. So both mum and dad were non-Christians when I was born at the time. And throughout my childhood, you know, I wasn't really raised as a Christian. But throughout my childhood, I was raised in some ways being raised as a Christian through different routes. So, for example, when I was 11, I went to Hong Kong, and grandma would, when we visited my grandma, would often encourage and ask us to go to church.
Was she the first Christian in your family, you think?
Yeah, well, actually, my uncle was actually the first person to become a Christian. He was a Christian, so he was a Christian around sort of the early 1980s, and he actually met his aunt. His aunt was my aunt is also a Christian, and they both were studying at the Hong Kong Baptist University. And yeah, it's at that point, because they were at Baptist University, they had more of like kind of a Christian input to it, both of them were trained to become teachers, actually. So that was really significant. And in that part, they spread the word to grandma and granddad, who wanted to become, you know, at that time they believed more in sort of like believing in ancestors, and you know, every time when the grandparents kind of pass away, they kind of go up to the mountain and then, you know, just do
right.
And, like,
Chinese ancestor
ritual
honoring kind of,
and yeah,
worship somewhere, yeah, between worshiping and them and just, yeah.
Yes. And that, and what really encouraged grandma to become, and granddad to become Christians, was they said to my uncle, "I've had enough. I'm having enough of having to do this like every single year, doing this kind of all this ritual business." So my uncle said, "Then follow Christ. If you follow Christ, you don't have to do all these kind of burning, you know, burning rituals or something." And yeah, they accepted Christ, and kind of through there, they've kind of drip feed into my parents, actually. And
I mean, that's really amazing, because I guess you get this picture of they're doing these rituals, and for so many Chinese people, it's the ritual that they know in the back of their head, it's almost like it's meaningless, but they still just have to do it. And I guess for your grandparents, they came to this point where like, this is meaningless. Where is the truth behind it? And then they end up following Jesus. And then you said, then they start telling, I mean, I guess your parents about it. And then that brought, is that when you guys would go back to Hong Kong in the summers or whatever? Is that when that started happening?
Yeah, so in the summer, we go to Hong Kong like every two, three years, we go back to Hong Kong. And you know, my grandparents always really encouraged mum and dad to go to church, because that's what they would do every Sunday. And you know, grandma just kept persuading dad, saying, "Yeah, you know, there's something empty in you. You need to go to church." And dad was really, really obedient. He was like, "Okay, I'll go to church with you." Yeah, every time we go to church, you know, the difference of seeing my parents when they go to church is absolutely phenomenal. It's like they become like change people, but change people for the good, instead of like just being themselves and just focusing on like, you know, work or money or whatever. And that's always been, so that's always the thing I always look forward to when I go to Hong Kong. And it was actually with that I suppose that's where the kind of Holy Spirit kind of really filled in us, because when we go to church, we always feel blessed by Jesus, but when we're not at church, we don't feel blessed as such. And I suppose when we talk about 2007, when I was finishing my A-levels, I mean, we already booked our flight to go to Hong Kong over the summer. So it's kind of like, it's all kind of like pre-planned already, but kind of like, during sort of February or March, it was the Holy Spirit really kind of filling in me, and was just speaking to me, saying, "Yeah, Matt, you're going to go on a journey. It's going to be a really tough journey ahead, and you know, I want to show my love to you. And if you do, and if you want to follow me and just want to know who I am through time at university, then now it's time to accept me, you know, accept Jesus as Christ and Savior.
So was that that was your A-levels? Were you 17, 18 at that time?
Yeah, I was 18, just to turn 18.
And it must have been really special to get baptized with your parents as well.
Yeah, my parents kind of had something very similar because they were feeling empty as well. And I think when they realized, like, yeah, I'm going to Birmingham and I'm going to university, obviously there'll be something empty in them because I won't be with them like all the time because I'm a horse or I'm renting accommodation at university. And it felt like they needed someone just to kind of, at least they want someone to talk to. I mean, that's where, again, the Holy Spirit really filled mum and dad. And yes, you know, they've spoken to them. And once we all had the Holy Spirit, we spoken over dinner and we said, like, oh, this is really strange. I've had this from the Holy Spirit. And it's like, and they said, oh, we've been spoken by the Holy Spirit. And it's like, this is a bit curious. You know, is God telling us something? And we prayed over it over dinner. And at that point we thought, okay, actually, Jesus, you know, you are really loving, and we want to accept Christ as our Savior. And at that point, straight away, Dad made a long distance phone call to Hong Kong, chatted to the pastor, and the pastor said, okay, you know, it's okay. You can become Christians. You need to do a baptism course. But you're only going to be in Hong Kong for like 3 weeks, so we'll have to do sort of like a fast track baptism course, and we did a fast track baptism course when we flew to Hong Kong, and yeah, when we were baptized, we decided to be baptized in Hong Kong, because you know we could have been baptized in the UK, but I think the impact of us being baptized in UK would be far less greater than we were in Hong Kong, because we're in Hong Kong, we have family in Hong Kong, we can invite people in Hong Kong as well. And it was great just for grandma just to see our baptism, because she's been praying for us all along for us to follow Christ. So when she saw our baptism, she was just absolutely amazed about it.
It'd just be so amazing. I mean, I know as a parent, when you really want to see your kids come to know Jesus. And so she doesn't just get to see like her kids, she gets to see her grandson as well. Like, there's so much joy in that. I think that's just amazing. I want to ask you if you, because I know a lot of people still today, they might have the feeling, especially because of lockdown, like feeling alone or feeling like they're not able to talk to you. Like, what would you want to say about Jesus and, you know, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? What would you want to encourage them to do during this time? Like, especially if they don't know God at all.
So, yeah, I think for people who don't know God at all, I think there's a few questions you've got to ask yourself. I mean, what kind of like makes you happy? Because, you know, as much as you want, you know, some people turn to food, some people turn to alcohol, to drink. Some would just turn to watching TV. But I think again, the question is, what is the purpose of life? You know, what is your main purpose of it?
And I love your two questions. You know, what is it that really brings you not just happiness, but joy? And what's your purpose in life? And as you start to explore that, you've got to start have to find out who God is. So thanks a lot, Matt. It's been really great talking to you. And I really loved hearing those stories. So if you're interested, you can always drop Matt a line, talk to him more. And he is our church chairman for now.
Until
the AGM gets restarted. So it's been great talking to you. Speak to you again soon.
Yeah.
Let's come and worship.
Hello, good morning. Welcome to BCEC Sunday Online Worship. I'm really glad to be here to lead the worship today. And before we start, I just want to read you a portion of the Psalm 113, okay? It says, praise the Lord, praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Here we know that we are commanded to give God all the praise, and I know just the song for it. From From the rising of the sun, to the going down of the sea, the Lord's name is to be praised. From the rising of the sun, give you all the glory and praise, and we're grateful and thankful for your faithfulness in our life. You'll never change, Lord. Hallelujah.
Oh,
Continuing our series on life in lockdown, and I'm in a different room today. This is actually kind of the workroom or the study for myself and also for the kids. During lockdown, this is where the kids have been doing all their homework, and some of the homeschooling's been done here. This week, we've had them working on papercraft, sort of polygons and understanding shapes like dodecahedrons and things like that. Part of Foster and Partners Architecture at Home. I'm not sure how much they learned about architecture, but they had fun making these little models. And I thought it's actually really nice when you can work on something and you can build it and have it come together. And I want to let you in on a little secret. Some of you guys may already know, but I worked on a little project myself probably about 4 years ago. And I decided that for the season of Lent, just before heading into Easter, for those days heading into it, I was going to write a poem day. So instead of giving up something for Lent that year, I thought I actually wanted to produce something and give to God as a little bit of worship each day. So I'd spend time reading his scriptures, reflecting on it, and then putting together a little poem. And then I put all those poems together, I bound them all up, and I put them in a little book, and I thought maybe I'll sell these as a fundraiser, but then I got really shy and I put them on my shelf, and there's a bunch of them just hiding away on my shelf. But I thought, you know, maybe I'll read you one of the poems, and don't worry, this relates. I wrote a couple soliloquies in here, imagining that if Peter or even Judas were speaking, this might be their poem. So let me read this out. This is Peter's soliloquy. Cursed are these lips which spoke forth such lies, to deny my Lord, to save my own hide. Thrice I was asked, was it I by his side? Three times I denied it, three times I lied. And yet just hours before I boldly claimed, I would never deny him, my heart was aflame. I denied him then denied him again. Cursed soul, cursed mouth, cursed my name. Fear not, he told me, trust my life to him. Acknowledge now, he'll acknowledge then. Deny him now, won't he deny me then? No grace I deserve, heart guilty of sin. And now alone in the dark, I stand still. Betrayed my Savior, what a bitter pill. Selfish heart revealed at the cockerel shrill. O Lord, have mercy on my soul's weak will. Now, the reason I'm sharing these poems with you is I'm not trying to hawk a book or sell a book, but rather I want to talk about actually kind of the artwork and craft that goes into even poetry. It's involves things like meter and rhyme and rhythm. It sometimes rhymes, sometimes it doesn't. But I think part of the art of poetry is at the end, it wants to take you someplace deeper into understanding either the human condition or even just something small like appreciating nature or some observations. But in poetic form, there's this creation of bringing something different to light. It is artistic and at the same time, it is expressive and hopefully imaginative as well. Now, the thing about these poems that I've written is I worked pretty hard on them. Some days they came really quickly. Some days I had to spend more time trying to craft and look up rhyming dictionaries to see what sort of words kind of rhymed. I'd have to reflect and look at the scriptures and think, God, you know, what are you saying in this passage? How can I express it in a small, concrete way? But even after I did all that, and these are from 2016, I made a bunch of copies and I stuck them on a bookshelf in my wardrobe, and they're just kind of sitting there. The sad thing is about this is actually so many of the works that we kind of do or reproduce, we kind of put them on the side and they just kind of sit there and gathering dust and we don't know what to do with it. And the reason we do that is because we think they're not good enough. And maybe it's true, this is probably not good enough to actually be picked up by any publishers. But you know that feeling, right? When you feel like the work that you do isn't good enough or the things that you produce don't seem to amount to very much. Now, when we look at that spiritually, it's also kind of intense, isn't it? We all want to do something great for God. We want to be part of his great mission. But then we stop and we think, well, you know, I'm not that smart. I don't have a Bible college degree. I'm not that holy. I'm not that spiritual. And we stop. And there's this kind of regret that a lot of us have, right? We have the sense of, I wish I was doing more for God, or I wish I could be used by him in a deeper way. I don't know about you, but I felt that way a lot. I guess you get so used to growing up thinking, oh, you know, I'm a failure, I'm not good enough, I'm not able to do these things, that even if we do produce something halfway decent, and when I reread these, I think, well, some of these are not bad, we can censor ourselves too quickly and think, well, you know what, though? It's not the best. And if it's not the best, should I even bother sharing it? I think that's one of the reasons why I have so many songs sitting on my hard drive, or I have poems lying around or drawings I've made that I'll never share with anyone. It's because I'm ashamed of the lack of good work that I'm able to do. Now, when we think about our spiritual lives and we think about trying to give to God, we're caught in this place, aren't we? Part of us feels like, well, I know God wants to use me and I know God's able to use me, but I myself, maybe I'm not good enough to be used by him. And this is where we come to today's scripture, and I want to read this verse out. And this is from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. And it says, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Another translation says, instead of God's handiwork, it says, "We're God's workmanship." The word they use there is poema. And that's where some people think that's where in the English language we got the word poem. But I think more importantly, it's this idea that we are somehow meticulously crafted. There is work that goes into creating us. We're not just thrown together randomly. And so even for my poems, there's thought, there's reflection, there's trying to make things work together. In the scripture, we get this picture to realize that actually, hey, we are actually God's workmanship. We're his handiwork. There's something in us that we are produced by the hand of God himself. See, the first part of this passage in Ephesians, and let me read it out for you. In Ephesians, starting from verse 1, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind." Now there's a lot in that passage, but basically to kind of summarize it, it's saying, look, we used to be the people like this. We were caught in sin. We were objects of wrath. And there's this phrase that he uses there where he says, actually, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. In other words, no matter what we did, no matter how hard we tried, we were, all the work that we produced, we were being worked in by the nature of sin. It was irreplaceable from us. No matter how hard we tried, we couldn't make ourselves good. We couldn't make ourselves right. We would always be falling short. And then the passage continues. "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not by your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." See, it's trying to contrast three actually different parts of work. There is the work of the sinful nature, of evil, of death, of Satan. And that work has been so put inside our lives that it's inseparable. That even if we tried to be holy by our own strength, we would fall short. We just couldn't do it. And no matter how hard we wanted to say, look, if I could be good, then maybe God would accept me, we would always fall short. And the flip side is saying, actually, God, in the work that he does, he has created a way for us to be saved. In other words, he takes us from that old life that we had and turns us into something new. It is God's handiwork and God's workmanship that does that. And it's in Christ Jesus that he brings that to life. It's this idea where actually nothing that we can do by our own power can give us salvation or can make us right with God. But only God himself was able to do that. It's this total contrast between the way the sinful nature of this world wants to tear things down and the love of God, which built us up. I'll give you an example. There's this, I've got this little mannequin here, one of these posable figures that you can pick up pretty cheap in the store. And no matter what I do, I can try to bend this character into all sorts of different ways and create them. This, as much as I wish this could be a Pinocchio type thing and bring this figure to life, it's never gonna happen. Even if this thing had the power and the ability to itself to move on its own, it wouldn't. It would still be robotic. It couldn't actually change its nature. It would still be a wooden mannequin. Now, I don't know about you, but I think for a lot of times, this is how I feel. Like in my life, I feel like I'm just pushed along by the forces of nature or pushed along by the forces of work and the destiny that's already been set before me, it feels like. And it feels like even no matter what I do, like I'm never going to be fully alive. But see, that's not true. Because what we just read in the scripture is that Christ did something to us. When you believe in him, when you follow him, he doesn't just leave you as a wooden mannequin left here on earth, but rather he brings you to life. He breathes his own life into us. I mean, there's other parts in the scripture where it says, once we had a heart of stone, but now we have a heart of flesh. Once we did not know God, but now we do know him. And it's this beautiful picture that we're not just decorative or we're useless, but that we're actually God's handiwork. It's great because actually in the scripture, it actually says, God raised us up with him, Christ, and seated us with him, God, in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. In other words, because of what Jesus has done, we have been raised to life and we are seated with him in the heavenly realms. Like, that's amazing. We're not held back anymore. We have really and actually come to life. I think our hard part is we haven't grasped the reality of what that is. We are spiritually living creations because of Christ Jesus. And it's in that context that we read then verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. It's a beautiful realization that here on earth, actually, we are already spiritually in the future tense, seated with Christ in the heavenlies. And yet, while we are here on earth, we are God's workmanship. We are still being crafted, we're still being refined, we're still being molded. Even though our future is secure, he is still working in us. Doing so, so that we can do the good works that he's intended. Like, we have a purpose, we have a mission here on earth. It's not just to exist or to be a model in the background. We were designed to do the good works that God has already set before us. Now, when we think about good works, I think for a lot of us, we think about, oh, it's about being good. No, I think holiness is the just what we should be already. That's how we should be living. To do good works means actually that you're producing something significantly different than you would in your own life. Think for a moment about God, the goodness of God, the nature of who he is, the majesty and magnificence of God. When we saw Jesus here on earth, his goodness wasn't limited to he was just being a holy man, was it? His goodness extended into healing, into forgiveness, into drawing people close into relationship with him. His goodness extended into the miraculous of feeding hungry people, of opening and stopping storms. But his goodness takes it to the point where he even dies on the cross so that we could live. Like, goodness isn't just about being morally right. The good acts of God involves things like the power of God manifested in the world around us. I mean, what does he say in Genesis 1 after he creates something? He saw that it was good. Like, God's goodness overflows in so many different areas of life. Now, if we take that and we understand, hey, we are God's workmanship, we're God's handicraft, created for his good works, you begin to realize, actually, we now have the opportunity to do and be part of the goodness of God in everyday life. Now, I think all of us like it when someone says you've done something really good, right? I think we all take a lot of joy in it. And it's nice when you cook a meal and everyone says, wow, that's really good. Or you're watching this on live stream and someone says, oh, wow, you've got 80 viewers today, right? Everyone likes that kind of sense of good goodness or praise, actually, right? Some sort of encouragement. It makes us feel better. Now, the truth of the matter is most of the time we don't get that. Everyone's much quicker to kind of criticize. You're much more ready to hear someone say, oh, Bert, why did you do that this week? Or look, last week you had 100 viewers, or maybe you should have added more salt to this. It's much easier to criticize or to tear something down. And because of that, and because of that critical nature, it can make us insecure or make us self-conscious. And adding to that, makes us start to think, well, actually, I'm not good at anything. I don't want to share whatever I've created. I mean, that's one reason why I don't share these poems, is because I'm a little bit shy. I feel like they're not good enough. And I'm used to hearing criticism that's made me insecure. But the thing is, when we talk about God's good works, when we're talking about the things that He has created and the goodness that we're participating in, you don't understand, that's not our works that we're hoping to make good. These are God's already good works that we get to be a part of. It's saying, God, I want to do and be part of whatever good work you're doing, so let me have faith that I, as your child, see in the heavenly realms, can be part of this and can do this. You understand then that it's not so much about the actual work, but it's about the faith that you have that God has made you His workmanship and desires to bring you into that good work with Him. So how does that kind of break down? It means that actually in every situation that we're in, we have to start asking God, God, can you do something good in this? Can you bring and share your goodness in this situation? And then it's not just saying that, it's actually saying, God, how do you want me to pray? God, how do you want me to speak in this situation? You understand, our faith should be increasing and multiplying and pushing us forward in this situation. We're saying, actually, God, I see that you have designed me for good works. Like, that is my job. That is my mission. That is who I am. Let me go forward in that. And it starts, yes, with holiness and being right. You want to be a good, operating, smooth, working machine. Because the holier and the closer you're walking in holiness, the better you can hear from God. The more focused you can be, the less distracted you are by things outside. But then when we start moving forward, you're saying, okay, God, I'm in my workplace not just to work, but to do excellently in this work for you, to show righteousness, to do things well. But not only that, to listen to the people around me, to share your truth. Like, if all the risk is on us, then of course we would be scared, right? But if you know that actually our God is so good and He's so marvelous and so great, like, what's going to hold us back? If you know and you see someone who is missing God, who doesn't know Him, who's living in fear during this time, wow, shouldn't we be looking for a way to share God with him? To tell them why we believe? To tell them why we're not living in that same sort of fear? To pray for them? If there's someone who's ill or suffering, isn't that our job or calling to say, God, your goodness overflow in this person's life, let them be healed. If someone is mourning, doesn't it mean we come alongside and weep with them and cry with them and share with them, you know, actually, but God's love is also here with you, and God, you comfort them. Being designed as God's handiwork and workmanship for God's good work means it's not trying to bring glory for ourselves. It's doing everything I can to point the glory to God and to invite God's goodness and His work to be shown in people's lives. I think we are sometimes just too hesitant, or we're too fearful, or we're too insecure, that we hold things back. But we need to stop and realize, actually, we are God's special handicraft. And He's called us into His life. He's given Jesus to save us, to bring us in this family, not just so we can be mannequins in the background, but rather so that we can be instruments of His good work that He has set out beforehand. And so I'd ask, well, does someone need prayer? Pray for them. There and then on the phone or video chat. Don't wait till later and don't say, oh, I'll pray for you later. Offer to pray for them. I mean, what's the worst that can happen? They say no. Tell someone about Jesus. Someone that you know, someone that knows you're a Christian. Take this chance to say, well, let me tell you why I believe. Let me tell you why I go to church. I think for a lot of people, they don't understand why you would do this. But if you know, actually, it's because Jesus is real and He's alive and His goodness flows through you, don't worry. I mean, what do we keep seeing in the Bible? The Holy Spirit gives the words to the people as they speak. So trust, know that God is using you for this way. So let's take part of his work. Let's be eager to see his life flow into the many people around us. I thought I'd end with the poem, the last poem that I wrote for Lent, and it's in, on the back of my book, and let me read it out. It says, "He who has the words of life spoke his words to bring forth life. Yet through our words we tore life down, yet the word turned lifeless death around. For from his words give deathless life, for he the word is eternal life. Let his life in your words resound, and let your words in him abound." Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, we thank you for your amazing word. We thank you for the word that dwells in our heart. We thank you that because of your word, we are alive today, because we have heard someone speak it to us and we felt your spirit convict us. And so we are alive. We are spiritually alive today. So God, cast away any doubts in our mind that we are somehow useless or not important, but rather let's see, God, that you are so important and you are so good that you have made us your handiwork. Let us be eager and active to be your agents of good work today. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's come and worship.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for giving us a hope and a future. Lord, during this pandemic, this lockdown, we realize that we have so much uncertainty about the future. We're anxious, we're worried, and we're afraid. But Lord, thank you, Lord, that you have come, that you offer us a life that's beyond this world. And Lord, you have gone through the whole way, Lord. You live, you die, you resurrected, and you have ascended. You've done all the work. All we need to do is put our faith in you. Thank you for your love for us. Let's sing this a very simple chorus together.
Stay.
is. Amen.
Shall we receive the benediction? Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Have a blessed week.
Beyond.